One, two, three. This is Dr. Alex Avila with Love University, and we're back. I'm an author, psychologist, and speaker, and every week we talk about how to love yourself, others, and a higher nature, how to improve your relationships, your personal health, your finances, your career, and of course, happiness. And love is a big component. And we have a guest that come on the show, and today we have a very special guest I'm excited to talk to. This is Cheryl Besner, who after 25 years of marriage, she found herself in a divorce at age 50, and she started to help people find love. She became a certified dating and relationship coach. She is an acclaimed radio and TV show dating expert on shows such as Solo in the City, rated number one on Saturday nights, Pillow Talk with Cheryl, The Morning Show. She's also an author and inspirational speaker. Welcome, Cheryl, to the show.
Thank you so much, Dr. Avila, for having me.
I'm great to see you. By the way, it's Avila, as they say in Spain, if you remember that.
Avila.
Yes. Now, Cheryl, in terms of the idea of falling in love, everyone wants to fall in love and to think that they're with that special person that also loves them. And, you know, we have these brain chemicals, things like dopamine that are released that make us feel intense, excited feelings, testosterone, sexual desire, and even norepinephrine, which increases, it's like a stimulant, increases alertness and attention to detail. And then we have those cues with our lover where a certain touch, even a smell, their cologne or perfume triggers those feelings. What do you teach your singles about how to deal with the chemistry part? How not to fall too deeply into that?
Well, actually, one of the things that we often talk about is chemistry, because especially people who are coming to me for the first time, they'll talk about, you know, the magic person that they want to meet, the perfect person. And they talk about, you know, I whether they've been dating or been in relationships, and they'll say, you know, I just don't have the chemistry. And, you know, you talk about endorphins, et cetera, that definitely are part of it. But one of the things that I try and do with my clients, whether it's, you know, one-on-one sessions or workshops or retreats, is go beyond that. Because the fact is, chemistry only lasts so long. And I even liken it sometimes to going into a laboratory. And when you take, you know, all these different chemicals and put them in, it might lava up and explode, but then it dies. Yeah, I try and get beyond that and really look into what it is that they need from a partner, and often discuss the fact that if you go on to a few more dates and give somebody a chance and you get to know them, that's when chemistry can really start. Like the chemistry that's going to take you forward.
Yes. Because I think there's two possibilities. One is there's intense chemistry, but you don't really get to know the person and you may be incompatible. And the other is when there's not really that much chemistry, but the person is very likable. Now, is it possible to develop chemistry over time, or is that something that has to be instant?
No, it's actually the best kind is the one that goes over time. You know, that flicker of light when you light a match only lasts for an instant. And that's why we differentiate, you know, my show Pillow Talk with Cheryl on Voice America, it's called Life, Love, and Lust. Uh-huh. And I try and have people really focus on life and love. Yes. Lust is a great, you know, a great emotion and something that we enjoy the feeling of, but it's fleeting. And it takes more. And especially in this day and age, there is so much opportunity for people and so many different ways for people to meet that it's about taking the time. And especially at the beginning, you know, we know for a fact that men really attach themselves in a different way when they know a woman, when they feel secure, when they feel connected to that person. And that's not something that that happens through sex. It's something that happens with them actually connecting to who you are as a person and respecting you and really understanding who you are. And it sounds like it shouldn't, or a lot of women will say, no, it's just sex. And I'm like, no, actually, if you want a better chance of having a relationship with a man, don't have sex.
Interesting. Wait a little bit. So, you know, we talk in psychology about the different kinds of love. The eros is erotic, sexual. Yeah. Then we have agape, which is unconditional love, and also thanatos or friendship love. So I think most people want to get a combination of all three, but you're kind of saying start maybe with the friendship first. Start with compatibility and then see if you can get that spark lit in as well. But our society, you know, I think you talk a lot about dating and online and things like that, where people, you know, they see a picture and then maybe they go out on a first date and they find that initial attraction. How do we see beyond that? Do we need to teach people how to look for the inside first?
Well, I think that's one of the things is I'm not saying that when you go out and you start meeting people that having attraction isn't good. Yes. If you have it, it's great. And that's what you hope for. Right. What I'm saying is it can also grow. And I can tell you from experience, and I'm telling you from clients who, and as you know, as with working with matchmakers, what happens is you have somebody who says, well, I like that person, but there was no chemistry. But then you go out on two or three more dates, and all of a sudden you start getting deeper into the person, and chemistry, the chemistry becomes a head chemistry, something that you're attracted to, yes, that's beyond your loins, you know, and it takes you into a new realm. And that's really the important part here.
Yes. Because I think you said that, like, for some people, brains are sexy, or creativity, or even a sense of humor, or even kindness. Now, let me ask you something, Cheryl. You talk, I think, a lot about what makes a person attractive, you know, as a single person looking for a mate, a soulmate. And you say taking pride in your appearance is one. You mentioned talking nice to, like, other people, like waiters and all that, you know, treating other people kindly. But let me ask you this question, though. The idea of the yin and yang, you're familiar with the, you know, the feminine, yeah, masculine energy, right, that we all possess. Now, what should be the ideal combination? Because let's say you have a male who's kind of more sensitive, he's shyer. Should he be more assertive, a little bit stronger in his energy? And what if a female's more assertive? Should she be a little softer to attract a man? How do you advise people in that way?
Well, it's not about should they be one way or another. I think that we all have both energies within us, and it's about cultivating and not being afraid, you know, allowing yourself to be vulnerable to the other part. And often what keeps us back, yes, is the fear. So for often women, for instance, in modern day, we are successful people within our own right. We have businesses, we have professions. And often what I will see with the women that I work with is, like, I don't need a man. I don't want to, you know, I don't want to take care of somebody. I don't want to kowtow to somebody. I want them to be my equal. And the issue is that they're leading with their male side.
Yes.
And what that does is it really can, not always, but it can emasculate a man who is shy. Or if, yes, he's not shy, he's looking for a woman. He wants somebody who is in touch with their feminine soft side. They're not looking for a male counterpart. Yeah. And the same thing for men. You know, sometimes it's about showing your vulnerability, being open to letting yourself be emotional, get connected emotionally, being vulnerable. You know, a lot of men have a problem being vulnerable. People in general have a problem with that. So yes, it's about really allowing yourself to be who you are and not pretending that you're not, you know, a man. Like, if we go to, you know, typical examples that we've used in the past, it's about not a male not being afraid to cry at a movie. And then it's okay for a woman to show her feminine side and to be the woman, you know.
So I hear a doggy in the background. What if I'm a man who loves dogs and I'm very sensitive? Should I mention that, or is that too wimpy to talk about that?
No, not at all. You see, that's all part of it. Well, Jersey is part of Pillow Talk with Cheryl because, you know, my dog.
What kind of dog do you have? Is it a Cocker Spaniel?
No, he is a Yorkshire.
Oh, okay.
A Yorkie Terrier.
A cute one.
Okay. Yeah.
So, you know, they say that men actually have dogs are more attractive to women. It shows reliability and nurturing. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, I guess I would. You know, I think when it comes to pets, the one thing is, you know, you were talking about online dating, and people say, well, online, you know, it asks, do I have pets? And my answer is, do not answer that part.
Oh.
Because you're really trying to broaden your horizons. You're trying to be open to the community at large. And often, for instance, I am in a relationship with a person who did not want to date anybody with pets.
Oh.
Well, lo and behold, he is with somebody who has a dog and a cat because he got to know me. And then the dog came along with it. So it's also about, you know, does the person want the responsibility, et cetera. So when it's online, it's about putting as much information out there as you need without giving too much of things that are not important in the end.
Well, it's kind of ironic, though. If he has pets, why wouldn't he want a woman with pets?
He didn't have pets.
Oh, he didn't have pets. I thought you said he had pets, and then you had pets.
No, he did not want to date somebody with pets.
Ah, so you charmed him into loving your little your dog.
Well, the point is that I charmed him into caring enough about me,
yes,
that became irrelevant. And that's the point that I'm trying to make here, is that it's about putting out the things that are important and that somebody will be attracted to by their lifestyles, values, and goals.
Yes.
Having pets is not one of them, for instance. That is something, you know, that most, unless you're allergic, let's say, to cats. But even then, People, I know people that I've worked with who end up taking shots because they're with somebody who has a cat. And so they take their...
Are you a cat person or a dog person, Cheryl?
I'm a life person. So other than like snakes and rats, I'm not too crazy.
Okay.
I like pets and...
Yes. The other thing, Cheryl, is, you know, this is a common advice that some people give of dating coaches is to play a little bit hard to get, because that increases interest. And they did a study where actually men were more attracted to women that played hard to get, but they liked them less. In another study on Facebook, they showed women pictures of men who either liked them or didn't like them or didn't say anything, and they were more attracted to the men who were more mysterious. What do you think about that? Should that be a dating thing, to play a little hard to get?
I don't believe in playing games. I don't stand behind playing games. I actually think that if you want to be in a relationship, there's nothing wrong with it being out there. However, there is ways in which it can be a turnoff, and that's when somebody is showing it from a needy position or somebody is chasing something. So I don't think playing a game. Now, what I do think is very attractive, and a lot of these studies, the way it's put out there shows, you know, yes, they like hard to get, but what they really like is independence. So they want to know that you have a life, and that's male or female, you know, that you're not going to become the sole focus and that everything that is in life is going to depend on them to give it to you. So men do like women who have a lot of adventure in them, women who are independent, who have a good social life. It shows that you're an interesting person, and that's what people are attracted to. You know, you don't want to necessarily in high school go sit beside, you know, the wallflower or the boy sitting with his head in a book. You want to go to a person who is smiling, who is out there, who is drawing you in. And that's also when you were asking me about stepping out into the world. Yes, I think that we step out into the world every day with a smile on our face, and that's what we're going to attract. And we all have hard days, but even for ourselves, like there's days where, you know, struggle is hard or something's going on in your life. You have a sick child or a sick parent or a sick loved one, and you're not in the mood to smile. But if you do, if you put that smile on your face, you will, and look in the mirror, you will immediately feel a little bit better. And that's what's going to attract people to you. I think that's the key here.
Yeah, that's called the facial feedback hypothesis. Like when you smile, you release certain brain chemicals. You actually feel better.
That's right.
When they do that. There's one study that shows that females are more attracted to males that have proud faces as opposed to happy faces. And men like women who smile more. So that, if that's the case, should men not smile as much? And should women smile more to attract the opposite sex?
Well, I definitely think everybody should smile more. And I think
so
what they're also talking about is with the male is women inherently seem to love the bad boy.
Yes.
You know, everybody seems to love
kind
the bad boy.
Kind of a sour face, kind of like a little bit moody or something in some ways.
Serious. And I think it's like the Pavlovian dog theory, you know, like when you don't know what to expect, you know, the dog doesn't know whether he's going to get petted or hit. He approaches you.
Right.
So same thing, you know, for a woman, that mystery, you know, they like a little bit of a challenge. But when it comes down to it, women want a man who's going to be good to them. And men want to be good to women. I mean, that's the ironic part of this is ultimately we want to be good to each other. And men do like to provide and protect, and women like to nurture.
Right.
So,
but the initial meeting, let's say you have James Dean and you have Will Ferrell, which one would you take as a woman?
I'm going to say I will probably want the relationship with Will Ferrell.
Oh, there you go. Okay.
But I would probably want to have sex with James Dean.
Okay. The bad boy wins in that department initially.
Well, but again, so what are you out there for? And that's when I'm working with women and men, but you know, predominantly I work with women. The first thing that I try and really define is what are you looking for? Are you looking for you know, 50 Shades of Grey excitement, or are you looking for, you know, a happily ever after love romance, a partner, you know, and they're two different people and both can be exciting, but one will be exciting for the long term and the other one is very nearsighted.
Yeah, that's a very good point. You know, looking for the long term relationship has different values. You know, Cheryl, things have changed. In the old days, they say you had to wait, I guess, 2 or 3 days to call someone. And now people text each other, like, what's the protocol today? Do you text someone to go on a date? Do you have to wait 3 days or do you do it the same night? What's the new protocol these days?
Well, I mean, I think it first of all depends on how you're being introduced. So if you're online, the first thing is to get offline as fast as you can. So that's, I see your profile, you see mine, we have a couple, you know, back and forth texts. Don't become pen pals, get offline and have it in this day and age, either a Skype or a FaceTime. You want to see who that person is because so many people complain about being ghosted, which means the person doesn't, like all of a sudden disappears, or Pinocchio syndrome, which means they're not exactly who or appear the way that they do in a profile. So to me, you get offline, you make a connection. You know, technology is there. It gives us the advantage of this day and age not to be ghosted and not to do Pinocchio, but we don't use it. So if you're online, get off of the back and forth. Don't become pen pals. Have a face-to-face via the internet, whichever way you want. And then get on the date because that's ultimately what you're looking for.
Right. Now, sure. What if you, by some chance, meet someone offline, let's say at some place, how long should you wait to call the person?
Okay. So that was what I was, the next point. If you happen to be you bump into somebody, you know, the old fashioned way at the supermarket, you're both reaching for the same steak or piece of fish or whatever. So many vegans out there these days, don't want to offend anybody. So you're reaching for the same thing and hi. Guys, don't wait. Women, it works for both, but women especially who value who they are, they think that if you don't call, you're not that interested.
If you call immediately, don't you seem kind of needy? That's the fear people have.
You're not feeling needy. You're like, wow, you really knocked my socks off. You're never going to lose a woman's interest by popping in there and saying, it was great meeting you today. I look forward to us, you know, getting together. There's nothing wrong with that. You're not going to lose anything. And the other person's going to feel great that you did it. And if you've gone out with somebody, and this is like a new matchmaker fundamental that most matchmakers are using these days. If you've gone on a date with somebody, they insist within 24 hours you call that woman because there's a lot of men who decide, okay, I'm going to wait a week. Then the woman has adopted the philosophy of, well, he really wasn't that interested and he really doesn't want a relationship, so they move on. And then the guy is like, wait, but I just, you know, was busy or whatever. We don't know. The person at the other end doesn't know what's going on in your life. They're making assumptions from their perspective. And the assumption is probably going to be they didn't like me that much.
And does the same thing work for a woman? Should they immediately call guys or should they wait a little bit?
You know what? In this day and age, and it depends, like millennials will do it. Older, more mature people who grew up, you know, in the 60s, 70s, in that dating world are a little less apt to do that. Personally, I think that, and when I'm working with my clients, I encourage them to at least give the green light. So you don't necessarily have to pick up the phone or send a text and ask them out. You just remind them that you exist in a way, or you thank them for the night before. I think everybody should do that. If you've gone out with somebody, you thank the person, especially if you're hoping to see them again. You know, thank them, show your appreciation, because in this day and age, that's what a lot of people feel is lacking, is the men feel that there's expectations and there's no appreciation.
So having kind of a kindness and a gratitude and a, you know, we call it loving energy here on Love University is a very positive thing, you're saying, for dating and for relating to people.
I think I think we should start going back to the word relating. It's a relationship and how we communicate. And, you know, we have to relate to date to mate and treat the other person the way you want to be treated. Somebody does something fine for you, you say thank you. Then you can reach out. One common way for I can give a suggestion, you've gone out on a date, you want to reach out to the other person. You know, you can say, hey, at this bar, I remember last night we were listening to jazz in your car. I'm at this bar. I know you can't be here, but thought of you, great jazz singer.
Oh, okay.
Something to that effect. That's you know, nice. Just it reminds the person that you're there, shows that you're interested in keeping connected.
Yes.
And you're not chasing them. You didn't invite them to it. Just right. saying this would be the kind of thing I think you would enjoy.
I see. Now, Cheryl, in the old days, they used to have this so-called rule where you wait 3 dates before you have sex or intimacy. And now I think you doubled it. You call it the 6-date rule.
Yeah.
Why? Have things changed now?
Well, first of all, I don't even know who started the 3-date rule.
Yeah,
and you know, when I was younger, it wasn't 3 dates. It was a lot longer than that.
Yes.
And I don't think I'm that old. But I think the first time I heard about the 3-date rule was I was just recently separated, and I was on a car ride with a male friend. We were taking a long drive together, mm-hmm. and he was giving me like the lowdown on the dating scene because he had lost his wife the year before, and he was trying to bring me up to speed.
Yes,
and he said to me, "Well, you know, there's like the 3-date rule. Like you have to have sex by the 3rd date because you don't want to waste your time, and you know, and if not, you know, the other person doesn't think you're interested, so you should get a you know, get in there and." Have sex. And I'm like, but why? Like, why is that? And he's like, well, because you don't want to waste your time. And I'm like, well, I don't think getting to know somebody is wasting my time. Plus, if I'm having sex with every person that I date on the 3rd date, I might be sleeping with a lot of people before I decide to get into a relationship.
Of course. But now you know, have the 6 dates. Is that still the same thing or is that something else?
So the 6-date rule is kind of my absolute limit. And that's kind of when I say the 6-day rule. First of all, the 1st date in Cheryl's guidelines, the 1st date is a 45-minute. It's a pre-date. You just want to get to see the person. You want to see if there is a little bit of spark of chemistry and you want them, you want to leave them wanting more.
Right.
So you just get together and, you know, get a sense of, you know, you were talking about sense of smell and everything. You get a sense, but you're not wasting time, energy and money, you know, because dating and going out on these big long dates for dinner and everything costs money. So 45-minute rule on the 1st date. So now that leaves you 5. Now you've gone out for dinner. Yes. You've gone, you know, do an activity together, like do some things that show you whether you're compatible before you decide whether or not you want to sleep together. Like there's more to the long-term relationship. And in my studies and in my interviews with men, and there is not a single man who said otherwise. A few of them said, well, I ended up with my girlfriend sleeping on the 1st date. But when I asked men about sleeping with a woman on their 1st date, is that the person they're thinking of a relationship with? They say no. And their first thought in that, when if I say, well, what is your thought there? They will say, I wonder how many 1st dates she goes on.
Wow.
And the other person.
Now, Cheryl, speaking of not sleeping on the 1st date, I want to bring in my producer, Reggie, into this.
Okay, Reggie.
Shy gentleman. And say hi, Reggie, to her.
Hi, Cheryl.
Reggie.
He's a 25-year-old young man. He's very shy. He's never really had a relationship. And I've been trying to talk to him about it. And we have actually a little bet where I would send him on a date and pay for his date for up to $100 if he can find a woman to go out with. And it hasn't been working out. He basically had a cancellation. Another girl just wanted to be friends. So he's like one of those really nice, sweet guys. Can you help Reggie here for us? What can you tell Reggie?
Well, I think it's very nice of you to offer to pay for that 1st date. But I would suggest to Reggie, especially if he is shy, Reggie, or if you are shy and it's very hard for you to put yourself into a vulnerable position. And ladies, if you're listening to this, you have to understand that when I said about giving the green light, we do give a green light to the men that we want to date, which gives them permission to ask us out and to ask us out again. And they need that support. And
so
we
Reggie,
should
tell Cheryl, what's been your main issue so far in getting that 1st date?
Well, like I've gotten better at interacting with women, like just like that I meet or whatever, like at clubs and bars or whatever. But it's just I feel like kind of escalating, you know, kind of like, oh, do you want to go get a drink or whatever? And maybe like understand, like when I say a drink, I'm like asking you out, you know, like understanding.
So you're not being clear about it, Reggie, or what is it you're saying?
Yeah. I don't know. I feel like I get mixed signals. Like some of the girls, they understand right away. They're like, oh, I'm sorry, I'm not dating right now. Others are like, Oh, well, I thought you just wanted to be friends or whatever.
I see. So, Cheryl, how do we get him out of the friend zone, the perpetual best friend for two women?
So here's the first thing. Number one is Reggie's talking about going to clubs and meeting women there. And what I was going to suggest to Reggie is, Reggie, tell me the things that you love to do. Like, do you have any passions? Biking, tennis, swimming? Is there anything you love doing?
Yeah, well, I like reading, watching movies.
He's an introverted energy, so he's never going to leave the house, Cheryl. What do we do?
Yeah, he's going to leave the house. Okay, so if he loves to read, Reggie, if you love to read, one of the things that I would suggest is become part of a reading club. You know, start getting out there, because the more you're able to exude yourself and put yourself out there for people to get to know you and to feel a different energy from you, because if you sit in that solitude space, they can't attach to the male part of you. There can only, the furthest they can go is to the friendship part of you. So there is a personal development that will come with the experience. And then as far as taking it to the next level, well, it's about where it starts. You don't just go from friendship into the next level. It has to start at that level. There has to be that element of relationship driven and wanting to date. Yes. And never let yourself get into the friendship zone. And you're going to, listen, we all suffer every day, you know, with different things that we have to challenge ourselves with and overcome our fears and take that step. But the first step for you is trying to put it out there, being more comfortable to have these conversations and to be able to express yourself. And the easiest way to do that is by doing the things you love, because you already have something in common. And you may not meet somebody at, let's say, a book club, if that's what you love, but you will learn how to communicate more, and you'll become more relaxed with your communication. And that will then spill on into other places of your life.
Great. So Reggie, the idea is great. Exude yourself, like express your best self. Now, Cheryl, are you going to pay for his date if he goes to Canada? Is that the deal?
You're forgetting what I just said. First date, 45 minutes or less, which means...
Oh, okay. Well, it's going to be a cheap date. It'll be a coffee.
It's going to be a very cheap date for you, Reggie.
There'll be Starbucks, right? We can't afford that, right? So yeah. Now, should the second date, should Reggie go all out, put on his tuxedo and take her to a fancy restaurant? Or should that be the fourth date?
No. So first date is a small one. Second date, if you want to go to a restaurant, great. But again, that's why I say to people, don't do these big extravagant restaurants. It's not necessary. The best thing to do is an activity on a second date. Uh-huh. It gives you something. It gives you an action. It gives you a way in which you can possibly even have a physical touch with that person. You know, doing different activities sometimes allows you to experience a natural conversation. And I don't mean an activity by a movie, by the way. That's out. But
maybe riding a bike would be nice. Bike riding sounds like a fun.
Riding a bike would be nice. Going for a long walk would be nice. Going to play pool, going bowling. You know, bowling is a great thing. I mean, so many people, when I first tell them to do that on a date, they go, yeah, no. And then they realize they haven't done it since they're a kid, and neither of them know how to bowl. And that in itself is so great. I'm telling you, I've had so many people go on dates and go, you know what? It made me laugh. And what's the number one thing women want to do, or what they look for in a man? They want a man to make them laugh.
See, Reggie, so they'll throw a few gutter balls, make a few jokes, and you might have a connection there. And maybe find a woman that likes to read. That would be good too. Well, Cheryl, this has been a great time having you with us today, and we really appreciate all this feedback, all this love advice. Because really, people are looking for love deep down, and they need people like yourself to help us. Where can people learn more about you? Do you have a website or any materials or things?
Yes, I do. My website is CherylBesner.com. You can also find me on Pillow Talk with Cheryl, Solo in the City, and Cheryl Besner on Facebook, as well as follow me on Instagram and Twitter. And the fact is, I'm always putting out on all my social media different I call them labor of love techniques. That's a feature of my show on Pillow Talk every week. And they're always online, and a lot of information, a lot of advice, a lot of inspiration.
Wow. And I think you have an upcoming book, if I'm not uncertain.
I do, The Dance of Love and Relationships.
Wow, we're looking forward to that. What's that about? Is it part of the same thing?
It's about the dance of love and communication, and that's because we do have to understand how communication works, and it is like a dance, and it's, you know, when one steps forward, the other one steps back, and the book really is a guide to having the communication that we want, and so that'll be coming out very soon.
Well, thank you very much again for being on the show, and if you have any questions for us for today's show or in the future, if you want to be a guest, you can reach us at lovetype4u@aol.com. That's LoveType, the number 4, letter U at AOL. You can visit us at loveuniversity.love. Call us at 310-226-8090. Like us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. So again, Cheryl, thanks for being on the show.
Thank you. By the way, they can also reach me on 844-744-SOLO. That's my 24/7 love line.
I see. Where do you live? Are you in Canada, Cheryl?
I'm in Canada.
Oh, perfect. Well, if you ever come down to LA, maybe we can collaborate on some activities or seminars.
And I'm planning on doing a retreat in LA and a seminar there as well.
Oh, perfect. Yeah, let me know when you're back in town. So okay, again, great. Love University students. It's been a pleasure today. So put away your pens, notepads, iPads, and books. Until next time, this is Dr. Avila with Love University.